experience with working with first being diagnosed with ulcerative colitis and then Crohn's disease in my own body for the last 11 years has brought me extreme clarity on the connection of our three brains, the one within our gut, our heart and mind, and the vital importance of having all three of these on board to maintain remission and completely heal. In reading Listen to Your Gut, I've been able to access your journey and how applicable you have made that, even simply in your title, you know, Listen to Your Gut, and the importance of our intuition when we connect body, mind, spirit when healing. So I would appreciate knowing your thoughts of the role on gut, heart, mind connection and how IBD and keeping it in remission is a very big part of your protocol.
I would love to do that, but first I need to ask you, when you say heart, explain to me what you're meaning by that.
When I say what, heart, I completely honor how our heart has so much intuitive memory. So when I study the mind-body connection, and I look at even stuff like research from the Heart Math Institute and how this one story of how a boy started calling his dog the wrong name when he got he received a new heart. I understand that unless our heart is really in it, and I've seen so many of the clients I work with, that they can have all the right diet and they can have the correct protocol and in their brain they have it straight, but unless their heart is in it, they have a hard time healing.
Interesting. Okay. That's very cool. And it's interesting because the Heart Math Institute, I've actually read more about their work through the horse stuff that I do. So because there've been a lot of experiments where they're hooking up, you know, horses and humans with EKG and realizing that, you know, even just if you're standing next to a horse and you're grooming the horse, your hearts are actually going to sync because there's a resonance there. So it's very, very cool, the stuff that the Heart Math Institute is doing. I think what you're talking about there, about if the hearts, you can have, you know, the protocol in your mind and you know what you need to do, and maybe your gut is telling you this is the way to go, but you just can't implement. So you're saying that that's something in the heart, and I guess I don't really know, but I do know that, and maybe we're going to talk about the same things, but just with different labels. So that'll be interesting to see how that comes about. But what I've seen, I call them blocks and saboteurs. So these can be actually experiences from, you know, your past that have kind of implanted a fear mechanism about moving into certain spaces or certain ways of existing in the world. And when you did that in your past, whether you believe in past lives or you just want to look at your past on this lifetime, it doesn't matter, whatever, your past, and you moved into that space and in some way you were punished or you lost a key relationship and we see this a lot with my readers. They may be in a relationship that is, you know, not supportive to their health on an ongoing basis. And so if they move into health and vitality, which involves connecting to your heart, to your soul, living from a heart-based place, they're going to risk losing that key relationship. And that's where they may go, I'm not willing to do that, or I'm not ready to do that. So I kind of allow for that in my program. And you know what? If they did lose that before they were ready, guess what? It's going to trigger their symptoms and they're going to be back in a flare because the dissonance and the stress of that is too much. So for instances like that, that's where I will tell people, well, you have to proceed at the pace that's right for you. You have to always stay in connection with your heart, with your gut, and just follow that leading and proceed at the pace of change that feels right for you. And people usually, you know, and then again, this is where I can't put my vision and hope onto other people, because for me, my vision and hope is, you know, complete, full healing, where you have a vibrant, you know, wonderful, meaningful life. You have no drugs. You have no, you know, you can do everything that you need to support your body through nature and through, you know, herbal and plant-based medicine and natural, you know, minerals and substances like that. But for someone else, they might say, well, as long as I'm off my drugs, I'm managing the cycle of my illness. So I'm not clear of my illness, but I don't need the drugs and I don't ever have to go back to the hospital. That for them is enough. And for this stage of their life or this lifetime, that's as far as they need or want to go. And so I structure things to let people make that choice and to just go to whatever level or place feels good for them and not have, and for other people it may be, I will stay on this one drug or I'll use this one drug as a crutch for a flare. And then that can work for a time. Like I've had people who were, you know, completing college, they're in their final semester, maybe they've got 3 months left. And I say, well, actually, if you just want to get through this 3 months, don't start my healing protocol, because to heal, you got to heal everything. And you know that when we go into the things in the heart that we've walled off and we've locked up, your physical symptoms can worsen because these are things that you just, and you're not, and you know, so there is a toll being taken on the body, but it's maybe not in the outer layers of the body because you clamped it all down. So then I go, well, you know what, maybe for you, stay on your drugs till you graduate and then prepare to go downhill for a year. Don't line yourself up for a big job right after you graduate. Say, after I graduate, then I'll start healing all these layers of dis-ease and unease that exist within my body, and I'm going to give my body the time and space to do that. So I'm not going to put pressures on myself when I graduate, and that's when I'll give myself the time. So I guess that's the way I see the different aspects of the self, you know, interrelating together and playing off. And again, always kind of guided by what the person's ready for. You know, how far can you get at this stage of your life or for this lifetime even sometimes for people? It's sad for me. It's, you know, that's something I've had to work on, to be accepting of that in people and not feeling like, oh, they just didn't do the whole thing. They didn't get where they could have gone, and go, no, that person, for them, they're happy. That's success. They've achieved what they wanted to achieve, and they have a level of freedom that they never had before, and just celebrate that.
Yes, I understand. So what I really hear you say, as in our Kabbalistic teaching, is honoring sovereignty and understanding the opponent. They call in Kabbalistic training the opponent, you know, that'll rear its ugly head, and working through the layers of that. But yes, I certainly do appreciate that confirmation on readiness, because the bowels are an incredible, intricate, amazing web of information.
Yeah.
And if we dive in too quick and too deep too soon, there'll be that backlash. Right.
Yeah, because again, it all comes down to the person's feeling safety. And I think this is another aspect that also ties into the heart and the gut, is if the person has a core belief or a core feeling, you know, do you feel safe in the world? Like, can you say, I am safe at all times? And, you know, maybe most people even can't. You know, and so I know for sure people with autoimmune diseases and allergies and bowel disorders, very few of them can say, I am safe at all times. And, you know, if you look at right from infancy, the whole let them cry it out thing. So the baby's crying and crying and crying and nobody ever comes. What have you taught that child at a visceral level? That is gone from their conscious mind now, but at a visceral level, that child feels alone and that child feels unsafe all the way through adulthood. And they have they don't know why, because their life, they're like, I had a good life. Nothing bad ever happened to me. I don't live in Syria. I didn't live in Rwanda. I have no idea why I feel so alone. And I feel that, well, that's been your earliest birth imprint. So, you know, then you have to kind of look at how all of these things play into it. And so for myself, the way out of that, because I did, you know, I continue to do utilize mind body therapies. As things come up, because healing, you know, there's always, I say to people, are you Jesus yet? Are people healed by just by having your shadow fall on them? No, well, you're not done yet. There's more healing to be done, right? So I take that approach to myself as well. And I keep going, oh, look, here's another layer. My horses are very good at showing me, you know, you need to work on that. And I'm like, oh, I didn't even know that was there. But you know, this whole concept of feeling safe and that being a real cornerstone. And I've worked with that a lot, and I've done a lot of EFT tapping and a lot of hypnotherapy. And I just could not get to that place of saying the world is a safe place. There's no way in authenticity I could say that and feel it. Because even in my own lifetime, you know, my grandparents, my mother is part Jewish, so my grandfather's whole family had to flee the Nazis. So everyone went to different corners of the world. And then in my lifetime, I was born in Kenya. President Kenyatta came to power and said Africa is for black Africans. So I'm, you know, third generation Kenyan, get out. And we had to leave. We had to my dad had to smuggle out enough money because we are not allowed to take anything with us. So we went from, you know, a swimming pool and rose bushes, he was an eye doctor, was making a really good living, to a two-bedroom housing project in Massachusetts, where we had, you know, virtually nothing. So even in my lifetime, having experienced that kind of political instability, where it doesn't matter how much money you have, it doesn't matter, it can be wiped out in a second. So never being able to go, okay, I can. How do I convince myself that the world is a safe place? Because if I'm not vibrating, then I'm not going to create that reality. And well, you know what? Tell that to the entire village in Rwanda who were, you know, vibrating at what? Holding what space of energetic reality? But they were all slaughtered. So the key that I found after like 25, 30 years of struggling and working through this is the key is not to look to feel safe. Or to feel that there is, the key is resilience. The key is knowing that no matter what happens, I can heal. And I think that's where the heart space comes in, to say, no matter what happens, I will not close off my heart. I will move into the pain. I will move through it. I will process it. I will rise. No matter what, I will rise. And so I think that's another way of, you know, getting to a root that's at the bottom of a lot of chronic illness is to, you know, and if that can help people, that would be, you know, and I put a tapping video out there on, you know, tapping for resilience versus tapping to feel safe and, you know, helping people get to kind of, you know, start even looking at that piece for themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Safety sits in our root chakras. Absolutely. Absolutely. And so tapping, I've loved tapping and I don't use it enough and I'm going to start using it more and more. And this was another reminder. Thank you for that. What other body mind connections have you found really helpful? Do you meditate regularly?
Yes.
Any other things you'd like to share?
I do. I find in terms of, if you want healing that directly produces an effect in the physical body, you have to look for a modality that integrates the mind with the body. So that's why I like the EFT tapping, because you have the mental process of verbalizing, inventing, and then reframing to a new possibility. But at the same time, you're tapping through all of the acupuncture points. So you're accessing the meridian body and you're moving the energy, the etheric body into flow. So anything that accesses about hypnotherapy is the same thing. You can, you know, you go into basically meditative state and then you dialogue with the subconscious. And a lot of people are combining hypnotherapy with tapping now as well to get the etheric body involved. Craniosacral therapy, which is done at that level of somato-emotional release. So, you know, you have levels of craniosacral, and you have levels of myofascial as well. Like John F. Barnes, who's kind of the father of myofascial release, he teaches physiotherapists how to move myofascial from just a tissue manipulation to this space of holding space for possibility. And he will have people on his table, their bodies will recreate the accident scene, for example, and they'll go into these unbelievable contortions that you think they're going to break their neck, but the body is doing it entirely on its own. And they are just energetically support. And what the body is doing is going back to the point of trauma to unwind and release it from this new reality of you are supported and you are safe. And we are helping you work through. So he has an amazing program. And then even just craniosacral, which is a lot more accessible for people, as long as someone is level two or higher, they can use the craniosacral and, you know, the cerebrospinal fluid and the rhythms of the bodies to get you into, well, what are the emotions and the trauma held in the actual tissues and cells of your body? And then you'll get it. You'll get like a memory. And it could be from childhood, something you've completely repressed. It could be, again, something that's happening in your daily life that you didn't realize is harmful for you. But as the person, you know, kind of moves your neck into that position or does whatever, all of a sudden that will come full front in your mind and you might start crying or you might just have a realization and then you can deal with it and release it. So that I find really, really awesome. And then for meditation, I prefer in terms of, you know, there's just your, you know, your Zen meditation or your mantra meditation. And that I find is really useful as more of a stress reliever technique, you know, where you can just drop into the space in between and leave the time space continuum for a while and sit in that space. That's really good. But if you want kind of more, I think more of this engagement of the mind with the body, because that the mantra and the Zen meditation, the Buddhist meditation is more transcendence of the body. And I think that's helpful, but I don't love that as much as I love recognizing that the body is the densest part of the soul. So we're not looking to transcend the physical. Why did you incarnate? If transcendence and bliss and nirvana exists when you transcend this physical body, this container, and you are your true self, why did you incarnate? Kill yourself. Done. You're there. You're back in spirit. You're fully, why are we here? Why are we in the physical body? But if we switch it and we go, the body is the densest part of the soul. It is not something to be transcended. It is not something to move beyond and then into our true bliss, but it is something to have that integrated even unto the physical form. That kind of changes everything. And so, and that in my experience is what produces physical healing and shift in the physical body. Transcending the physical body will make you feel awesome, will, you know, bring down your, you know, downregulate your nervous system and provide, you know, beneficial effects to your blood pressure and all those types of things. But if you have something like IBD, where you're looking for a deeper level of healing within the actual tissues and cells and, you know, your mucosal lining and for things like that, then I find a guided meditation is a lot better, because it will put you, then you can go to that place of deep relaxation. You can go to that space of connection with source energy or the divine or whatever name you want to give it. But at the same time, you are actively, you know, opening the chakras, moving energy through the physical body, sending it out your fingertips into Mother Earth, letting Mother Earth take it from you, transmuting it from you, bringing it up from the earth, bring it up from your body, rainbowing out the top of your head. These are the kinds of things, when done in meditative state, that can produce a more lasting change in the physical body. And of course, if you do them, you know, regularly, you can, and then also when you're, so let's say you do that to get your chakras opened up and your energy flowing, and now this densest part of your soul is connected to the highest part of your soul. Now from there, how about you start visualizing the actual piece of physical healing that's needed in your body, in whichever form makes sense to you. So like for some people, for kids, they kids are really drawn to, you know, like attacker victor imagery, right? So they may have this like dragon that goes in and eats all of those bad critters running around in their gut. That's a very powerful healing visualization for a child. Now, for me, that's not going to work at all because I don't resonate on that level. So for me, I would have a team of workers going in and they've got pots of salve and they're taking it and they're spreading it on the walls of my colon. And then they're setting up a cooling unit. So as it cools all that inflammation and the healing salve, and I can call on the power of the plants. I can ask the spirit of Arnica and the spirit of comfort to assist as I am, because they're in my salve. And so now we're accessing the plant world and we're bringing that medicine in. And because we're in meditative state, everything is very fluid, everything is very permeable, and we have access to tools that don't exist on this straight physical world. And so that's more the place that I like to use meditation, and that I see experientially, it produces a bigger effect in the physical body.
Beautiful. Thank you. And intuitively, as my editor and Michelle and I have been working on my book, Peace, Love, and Microbes, we have started putting visual meditations at the end, just feeling that would be that and gratitude, because for me, that's the focus of gratitude completely switches stress. And I really am very intrigued with plant medicine, and I've studied it to some degree myself. But while we're talking about that, I would love to hear a little bit about the plant medicine, maybe the herbs that have been really helpful for you. Some of the ones for me have been L-glutamine and marshmallow root and slippery elm. But I would love to hear maybe a list of some of the ones that you have found the most effective for yourself and your clients or patients.
Well, absolutely those three for sure. In a product that I formulated because, you know, something they didn't, I only formulate products that don't exist. Like if a product exists, I'll be like, go buy that, because that's easier for me than formulating it myself and, you know, having overseeing. I don't do the manufacturer, but I work with the manufacturer to make sure that they produce it properly. And that's, you know, it's all a lot of work. So if I can just send someone to something that's already there, I do. But you know, for my one product that's specifically for healing mucosal lining, it contains slippery elm, marshmallow root, deglycerizinated licorice, so that, you know, it doesn't raise the blood pressure, and pregnant women can use it if they want. Of course, we never recommend that pregnant women take anything, but just saying, or breastfeeding. And then it also contains N-acetylglucosamine, which is kind of similar in action to L-glutamine, but different enough that that I like it. I like to use it on its own. And then L-glutamine, we also use separately, either completely on its own on an empty stomach to suck the water out of the colon and firm up diarrhea really fast, or as part of the elemental diet shake that I formulated. It has like 1,000 milligrams of L-glutamine per serving because it's such a rejuvenator for the gut lining, and it really assists the healing. So those for sure. And then my other ones that I, aloe vera I love, but you have to be really careful of it because, you know, any part of that inner leaf that gets into, there's the clear gel and then there's the yellowish kind of membrane, and then there's the outer leaf. So you really have to kind of almost leave a layer of the clear gel on the sides and just take right from the inside, otherwise it'll have a laxative effect. So, you know, a product that has done that extraction but yet hasn't added preservatives and citric acid and things like that, because those are irritating to the gut. And then my other two ones that I absolutely adore are comfrey root, which again, there's a whole bunch of cautions, which are, you know, it's like 7,000 people a year die from aspirin, but we're supposed to be careful of comfrey. You know, it's just, it's, you know, now we're back into the big pharma, you know, money racket. So whatever, comfrey, I love it. I love it on open wounds, internally, rectally, into the colon. It is the fastest wound healer ever. And then my other one is wild oregano. Because, and I, people say to me, you're stranded on desert island. I'm like, I want wild oregano and I want comfrey. I have those two things, I got everything covered, because they are just so, and wild oregano, people, a lot of people don't know, you probably do, but wild oregano is also an anti-inflammatory, and it's amazing wound healer. They use it with burn patients. So, and you, and we actually had one of my readers, she got a third degree burn on her neck. So she's like, oh, I'm going to test that burn patient. So she made a dilution and she photographed the stages of her healing. And she said, yeah, it didn't, I was surprised because I was prepared for it. She says, there was no discomfort, there was no burning, and it just healed so rapidly. So those would be my top herbs that I like and I like to use.
So awesome. Great. And they're all ones that have been in my radar. Do you make tea with any of them? I have often a comfrey, marshmallow, slippery elm, licorice. Licorice.
Yes. Absolutely. And what I tend to do for, I don't like the taste of licorice actually. So I have teas, but I'll only take them if I have to, if there's nothing else, because I just don't like the taste of it. But for my kids and stuff, they don't mind it. So they'll take the teas. And then for the comfrey though, if you have, you know, bleeding in your colon, the fastest way to get to that is a healing implant enema. So you take the comfrey and the slippery elm and the marshmallow and you mix it in body temperature water and you just put as much of it directly up into your colon at a time when you're most likely to have empty bowels, so it can just sit there and really, and that will stop even intestinal hemorrhaging very quickly, like one or two applications. It's an amazing healer.
Do you recommend the same for aloe vera? A small amount of the inner fillet of the aloe vera up the rectum?
Yes. Yeah. And you can put it in the freezer, you know, to firm it up a little bit to make it easier. Otherwise, it would be like inserting mush, right? So you just put it long enough to get it a little bit stiff. And then, yes, you can insert that in the rectum.
Beautiful. And you had mentioned your elemental product. Could you talk to me a little bit about your vision product?
And about, sorry?
Your elemental diet, your shake that you recommend for people in the bowel healing phases. And maybe in that, you might talk a little bit about the importance of bowel rest.
Right. Well, the way that I kind of structure things, again, is in a way that they can still eat, you know, a certain amount of regular food or different types of food. I tend to direct them to that first, because not only is that easier for them to implement, but it's a lot cheaper. So the elemental diet is really only for people who cannot, they've lost the ability to digest and absorb nutrients from regular food. And on my blog, you know, I have a post up there. It's one of the favorites, using common foods to heal inflammatory bowel disease. Cause there's things like, avocados and bananas ripen to the point where they're black. So they're pretty much pre-digested. And if you tolerate dairy, you make live homemade yogurts. You get all those probiotics and enzymes and you throw this stuff in a blender. It's an incredibly powerful healing shake and it's cheap, right? It's accessible to everybody. So if you can use that, go for it. Absolutely. It's much healthier. The elemental shake product is for people who are past all of those things. And we have people like, you're either hemorrhaging or you're severely malnourished and your body's lost the ability to extract nutrients from any kind of food or whole food. And then, you know, the shakes, I think they work out to be about $6 a serving and you need a minimum of 4 or 5 a day. So it's not a cheap solution, but oh my gosh, it's basically like taking the person back to breast milk. So in that way, it's a highly processed food, right? It takes a lot of processing to take, you know, a carbohydrate or a protein and break it down to the level that exists in breast milk. So, but in the instances where it's needed, you know, we've had people who the doctors have told them to make out their will. And they start the Absorb Plus shakes, they gain 40 pounds and they're out of the hospital because it's that powerful. Or someone who's hemorrhaging, they can't have a single bite of food. It starts the bleeding again. well, 7 weeks on an elemental diet, and I know because that's how I developed it. I did it myself. I had all 10 of my mercury fillings removed at once with no support and no detox. Because this was way back in the day before we knew all this stuff. And we just knew that mercury was bad and you need to get it out of your teeth, but we had no idea about IV vitamin C and all the regimens that need, and that you must not take them all out at once. And so I basically completely mercury poisoned myself. I had my levels tested and they went off the charts. So we don't even know how high they were, but they were super, super poisoned, which triggered within 1 week massive intestinal hemorrhaging. So I'm 5'7". I went down to 99 pounds. My hemoglobin, I said to my husband, you have to actually take me to the hospital. I need blood. My hemoglobin was 3. And the ER guy was like, okay, I've been working ER for 8 years. We've had accident victims. We've had gunshot. I've never seen someone with a hemoglobin as low as you. And you're conscious. Like, how is this even possible? But I'd had a near-death experience right before I came in, and I'd, joined with the divine, and I know how everything's gonna be. So I'm coming in there, and I'm like, I'm laughing, and I'm making jokes, and I'm like, everything is fine. Don't worry about it. It was because,
wants to stay.
I know. It's like, it's all part of the plan. It's all good. And so when I came out, I developed this elemental diet product. That has then gone on to save the lives of thousands. So there we go. And I got rid of my mercury filling, so it's all good in the end. But in 7 weeks, I went from that 99 pounds hemoglobin of 3 to 135 pounds, working out at the gym 3 times a week, protein, albumin, hemoglobin, everything perfectly normal. So that is the rejuvenative power of this, breast milk type substance. So when you need it, or the other thing that people will do is they'll do a half elemental diet. And we actually have some clinical trials now where they've used a half elemental diet with people with Crohn's. And so they half is these elemental shakes, the Absorb Plus. Well, they used a pharmaceutical product, which again, I tested. I mean, they're just garbage. They're high levels of corn syrup. Really low grade protein sources, including casein and
An insure way of being sick.
Exactly. And they have ones that even like kind of the next level, they're up from insure, but they're no better in terms of ingredients. So, I just don't even touch those. But anyway, even using those products, because they do produce a level of bowel rest if you can somehow retain them, but you won't gain weight on those products. With Absorb Plus, you'll actually be able to gain weight. But anyway, half elemental diet, half, low residue or easily tolerated foods, outperforms any drug in terms of producing remission. So again, when you talk to the GIs and you say, why aren't you recommending this? They'll say, well, nobody sticks to it. Mm. So then we're back to that mind-body interplay, right? Like to drink nothing, but, and then as part of my protocol, which uses the elemental diet, people alternate with ideally bone broths. But, if they are absolutely against eating animal products, I do have a vegetable broth that they substitute for, but the gelatin in the bones is incredibly healing for the gut. So if, depending on where people are at with their belief system or their ethics or whatever, they might give themselves permission to consume bone broths for a period of time and then go back to their vegetarian lifestyle or whatever. People do what they want, but it's the information is there for them. And those two combined are just incredibly healing and give you this, huge break from digesting, processing, breaking down, because with the Absorb Plus, it's in your bloodstream in 20 minutes. So we've had people with end-stage AIDS use this product. We had this woman, everything she ate, within an hour, she would vomit. So she was not dying from any other symptoms, but she was dying from malnutrition. Mm-hmm. So she started on the Absorb Plus. Well, she still vomited after an hour, but it didn't matter. All the nutrients were in her system. So even though she was vomiting, she was gaining weight. And then, of course, you hit that plateau. Because this is the other thing that I've realized. When the body is malnourished, once it passes a certain state, it has no and very little self-healing mechanism power left. So you can give it all the herbs you want. The body's not going to heal because it it's like it has no juice, it has no energy.
Completely innervated, innervation.
Exactly. So the elemental diet brings you to that point where all of a sudden the body's own life force energy can restart and the body's own self-healing mechanism can kick back in again. And then, you know, the person takes it, you know, they may choose to stay on it or they may choose to start mixing it with the easily tolerated foods or, you know, soups or whatever works for them.
Beautiful. And you also just triggered a memory for me that I will put under my preventable degeneration section of my book. I actually had all my mercury fillings removed by a regular dentist a year before I got Crohn's. That is so very interesting connection for me. Thank you. I think I thought about it periodically, but I didn't give it as much weight. So I appreciate
You know, and I hear you because it didn't dawn on me for years either. I was racking my brain. I was like, I was fine. I'd been fine by that point for, I don't know, 5 or 6 years. Totally fine. And then all of a sudden I dropped off the edge of the cliff again. And I think I'd kind of gone, well, I guess this was a spiritual thing that I needed to develop. Because my protocols up till that point worked for everybody except that person who was headed for death, right? So, you know, there was still a segment of people who I were like, well, you're now into the med because this stuff won't work. Well, and this took it all the way. You can have the doctors write you off and this IBD remission diet will bring you back. So I assumed, oh, this was part of my contract, my spiritual commitment, my service to, you know, what I'm here to give. So I had to go through this. And it took me years for it to go, wait a minute, look at the timing of it. It was like 1 week. So, which doesn't negate the spiritual contract and, you know, something I've decided to come here to do, but it provides, because, you know, we're not just spirit, we are spirit and physical integrated. It provides that final piece of the puzzle that, aha, you know, so for you as well, right? Like, yeah, your mercury fillings were the trigger, but they're not the whole reason. Because it could have been you had your mercury fillings removed and you developed rheumatoid arthritis. Like, why Crohn's, right? Why getting into so far? Because the gut is, like you said, your gut is like this hub that then connects out to your heart, to your mind. Like, and every healing system in the world says the heart, you heal the gut, you heal the entire body, right? So, you know, that's part of your story of, well, why my gut?
And I see our stories quite interwoven. I had a same near-death experience over a different issue before I went to the hospital one time with Crohn's. And I remember that same accelerated experience of really knowing, because I remember being sent back, nope, you have work to do. And I remember that elevated feeling of being in the hospital for the first time and feeling very much like what we talked about early in this interview, that when it might not necessarily mean we always feel safe, but we trust that we'll always be okay. And that's what it sounds when I listen to you and connecting it with my own experience is that's what changed for me, is that no matter what goes on in my life after that near-death experience, I knew I would be okay.
Yeah.
And so maybe since a lot of this interview is turning out quite organic, I would love for you to share a little bit on your experience in working with people as when they get that on board, that trust, because I know how many people I've worked with when I said inflammatory bowel disease has been one of my biggest gifts in my life. It's really allowed me to be super clear, because when I'm not clear, my gut will tell me, nope, you're off base.
Right.
Instantly. So it's a gift. Mm-hmm. And often when people come to me and they see it as such a curse.
Yeah.
And
this thing is ruining my life.
So what do you see when you work with people and they can make that switch? Yeah, it's really helped me fine tune my boundaries, my sense of self, my self-worth. Maybe you can just share a little bit on that around the people you work with.
Well, I don't work directly with anybody. I don't have any health professional designation. I've done that on purpose so that I am free to say whatever I want in my books and my blogs. Yeah. So I don't do any one-on-one. I did for a time. There was a brief period of time where I did consultations. And then I realized, this is actually going to limit what I can do for a larger number of people, because now I'm going to be in that liability issue. So I stopped doing that. For the brief time that I did it, because again, it wasn't long enough and it wasn't long enough to walk too many people through the process, I more experienced people hitting their blocks. You know, I didn't see a lot of people getting to the place that you just described, where they're like, wow, this is like having a crystal ball in my body, instant guidance, instant feedback. It's a biofeedback machine, right? People have to go get hooked up to get this level of communication that I'm getting. I didn't see a lot of people get there. I saw a lot of people getting stuck in, more like this, the one story that keeps coming to my mind is of this fellow who, he was your typical type A performance driven overachiever, gone to the best schools. His family owned a, you know, bazillion dollar business, and he was going to be taken over from dad, and his higher self didn't want him to do that. And he didn't like it, and he knew it. But he was not willing to go through. He's from an ethnic family where, you know, the pressure is so high. And he was not willing to listen to his own body and say no and go his own path. So he would completely heal himself using the natural, all my protocols, all the products, because he had no shortage of money. He could, you know, buy whatever he needed. He would get himself perfectly healthy, and then he'd go back to work with his dad. And I'm not kidding you, within a week or two, full flare, bleeding, back in the hospital. And this happened over. And finally I said to him, I said, you know, I got to level with you, because this is what's happening.
And that's what Canadians do.
Yeah. And I, this is what's going on. I don't want to tell you there's no, but really, unless you're willing to make this decision, you're just willingly going through the same cycle over and over. And his decision from that, he was like, you know what, you're right. Because here's the thing, it takes way more work to heal yourself, to really heal yourself, which is what natural healing is, than it does to just take a drug that makes the symptom go away. So he chose to go back on drugs. Because he made a conscious decision. I'm not willing to listen to my inner guidance. I'm not willing to stand up to my father and say no. So I'm just going to go back on the drugs. So I don't know what happened to him after that. Will he spend the next 20 years on this cycle of attempting to go to work and maybe being able to work for 6 weeks before he's back in the hospital for another surgery? I don't know. But that's where you can't help people. You can only help them to a certain extent, and then it's their personal, journey, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Can you?
But I think that's a really important message for you. I think you should really bring that out in your book, because if you can storytell about that in a way that people can get that piece about, because I don't play on that a lot. Mine is more, I'm catering more to the actual physical what to do in my books. And I feel I've kind of checked in. I go, should I be getting more into the spiritual energetic? And I don't get a guidance to do that. Mine is kind of like a first level. So I get MDs and PhDs. I get hardcore scientists who, if I led with the energetic, they wouldn't pick up the book. So I get them in there, and by the time they're finished the book, they're like, they're talking, they're checking in energetically. So I kind of bring them a part of the way. But I think if you really brought that out in your book, that would be really powerful for people to start viewing their dis-ease as this messaging system. That's like you said, it shows you when to set a boundary. It shows you when you need to be doing this. It shows you, and if they could just look at that, just kind of flip that whole view, that one thing alone will change someone's life.
The power of the gut instinct.
Yeah.
Yeah. And how inflammation basically dampens all that down. And then we don't have to feel exactly what our instincts are telling us and to look at that. Thank you. I really appreciate that. I wonder if you can tell me a little bit about your experience around pre and probiotic. I've noticed that you've looked at single strains in the Natron line, and how some people, I know that some people are even starting, and like you had talked about infidus, you know, just starting with the infant first strain into the gut. If you just speak a little bit on pre and probiotic.
Yeah, I talk about the Natron brand because, and I even had people looking over in Germany for me, which is Germany's usually a leader in these types of things. There's nobody who is culturing, packaging, and shipping refrigerated the way Natron does. So it makes me look like a Natron salesperson, which I really don't like, but honest to God, there is no other brand who is maintaining all the steps needed to produce a therapeutic level of bacteria. And I've actually toured their factory down in California. I had to gown up, surgical gown. I had a mask, I had the cap, I had booties. I was covered from head to toe before I was allowed to step foot in their facility. And when I was in there, I was looking at, even the ceilings were spotless. So these are people who completely understand the intelligence and the adaptability of microorganisms. Like, microorganisms are so freaking smart, it's not even funny. Have you seen the work of, oh my gosh, blanking on her name right now, starts with a B, but she talks about how the bacteria talk to each other in the Bonnie something. Have you heard of her work?
Bonnie is her first name?
I think so.
Okay.
On Bazarus, anyway. So, example. People think, oh, I eat something tainted with, you know, bad bacteria, food poisoning, and then all of a sudden I'm vomiting and blah, blah, blah. Or I go somewhere and I catch an infection and then all of a sudden, blah, blah. They now know that's not what happens. What happens is the pathogenic bacteria get into your system. They don't make a peep. Your immune system does not know they're there. They lie dormant and they start multiplying and multiplying. And then every so often they wake up and they talk to each other. The whole mass of bacteria have intercommunication capabilities. And they say, hey, how many of us are there? Is there enough of us yet? Nope, go back to sleep. They go back to sleep. They keep reproducing. When they wake up, because they know how many they need to have a shot at overwhelming your immune system. So obviously they can sense the state and capability of each body's immune system to know when there's enough of them that they can have a chance at overwhelming you. So then they go, is there enough? Yeah, there is. Boom. All of a sudden you're vomiting. That's when you feel I have it. But they've been in there for God knows how long, can be hours, can be days, waiting until they're of sufficient number and strength to actually make a run for the goal. And that's when they kick into effect. And then your body goes, holy cow, invaders, and mounts it. So these are maybe single-celled organisms, but they encapsulate the intelligence of the universe. Like, we talk about a drop of water. Well, let's talk about a single cell as within, you know, so without kind of thing. So, again, Natron is the only company that I know of who is fully cognizant of this and so rigorous on maintaining, you know, the purity, making sure the strains, the species aren't mutating, making sure all of these factors that go into producing a therapeutic level microorganism. And then maintaining that, because it is a fresh live product, it's maintained at the required temperature at all times. And when it leaves their warehouse, their factory to be shipped, it goes in refrigerated. Now it can hit room temperature for about 24 to 36 hours and not lose vitality and not lose life force. And then when you're hitting into, you're edging towards 48, you're going to start to see a bit of a reduction. So when I have people try them, they get very different results from any other probiotic they've used. And there's a colon clinic in Sydney that took six of the top probiotics. They had these patients, they'd already gone through a series of colon hydrotherapy and cleansing. They were already on a very specific diet. Then they had them take the probiotics, and Natron was the only one that significantly increased the fecal counts. So they knew the bacteria were actually colonizing, they were actually having a therapeutic effect. And so then that's what made, they only used Natron in their clinic, and they actually use probiotic retention enemas of only the Natron bacteria to stop active bleeding Crohn's and colitis. Now that's something that I don't do. I think because I had experienced this intolerance that the body gets to any kind of bacteria, which is why, as you discussed, people sometimes they have to start with just the B. infantis, the baby strain. And sometimes they can only take a pinch because their body can go into a flare because they become hypersensitized to any bacteria, whether it's their own or foreign source or good or bad. The body is just kind of in a state, right? So that type of application just felt too extreme for me, felt too risky. But they've been using it successfully. So whatever, you know, that's where you listen to your gut. So, but for my readers, what I suggest is they start orally with just, you know, a pinch of whatever they feel led towards. Now, if you have diarrhea, you want to start with either the B. infantis, the baby one, or the bifidofactor, because that firms up the stool if you have diarrhea. If you have constipation, you want to start with Digestilac, which is an L. bulgaricus bacteria, because that helps to loosen the stool. But eventually, you do need all the species to get that really healthy gut flora. But you start with whichever one is most tolerated by your body. Now, if you're having a lot of heartburn, you're going to want to start with Acidophilus, because that's going to give you instant relief there. So you kind of play with it. You let the body see, look, we can help you right away. We can help you. And then over time, people build up, and they eventually build up to, you know, all three or all four species in the amounts that they can tolerate. And then the next step to that, where people find really helpful, is to do probiotic layering. So the Natron product comes in single species powders, single species capsules, and then the Healthy Trinity, which is all three species together, but each one is in its own oil bubble. So they're not touching. They're like this in the, yeah. It takes one week to microencapsulate them. So they have this machine, they had it custom built in Germany and shipped over. So everyone else who mixes species together, they're just mixed. They're all in there. And now they're competing for dominance. By the time you ingest it, there's probably one species left because bacteria are competitive. That's how they roll. So, you know, there's all these things, and the consumer doesn't know these things, but probiotics are a massive moneymaker. So everybody's jumping on it. And so you have a ton of people say, I tried probiotics, they didn't work. Or I tried probiotics, they made me worse. Yeah, because these are live creatures. And so you need to have a bit of intelligence in terms of where's your body at, how do you increase, which species do you start with? And again, the other companies don't break them up into single species powders, so you can't start with just a pinch. You know, you're stuck with whatever dosage they put into the capsule or what have you. So now the prebiotics. Prebiotics are great if you already have a healthy gut flora, because there's no discrimination between bad and good bacteria. There's species of both that eat the same food. I mean, obviously, because you eat the food that you eat. So obviously they're going to thrive on the same food supply. So prebiotics, same thing. If your gut is predominantly bad bacteria, you're just going to feed them as well. And so that's why a lot of people with IBD and IBS, if you consume prebiotics, you get an increase in gas and bloating pretty much very quickly. So I say no prebiotics. And again, that's why Natron never packages their bacteria with prebiotics. That's something that you can choose to do after you've got implanted a really good gut flora. Maybe you're at the stage where you can tolerate naturally fermented foods. So now you're fermenting your own vegetables, your kefir, your kombucha, and your system can handle those, well, then add in the prebiotics. And then, because you then they'll feed your beneficial bacteria. So it's just a matter of timing on that.
That was very helpful and brilliant. Thank you. A couple things out of this, and very helpful. I really appreciate it. A couple things out of this is, I think you were talking about Bonnie Bassler.
Thank you. That's her.
I'm going to research her a little bit more. I really appreciate that. And the other thing that I was going to ask you, it's slipping me for the moment, so I will just move on and I know I will remember.
Mm-hmm.
If you could talk a little bit about the power of getting all the allergens out of the system, and with those we keep irritating the gut lining, such as gluten and that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So I know, like, for example, I decided I've had some pretty major stress in my life the last few months, and very major. And I decided to try a little bit of gluten, and I instantly felt my immune system lower. I got cold sores. So just at how, when you get things out of your system, how much more your body will react to it. And sugar, a lot of grains, gluten being some of them, and how those continue. You can put all the probiotics or all the stuff in the world into your system, but if you're doing the offending foods, then you'll have a really hard time healing. So what's your experience on that?
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that. And I mean, the case for grains and sugars and carbohydrates is that all carbohydrates break down into sugars. So what do bacteria eat? They eat sugars. So again, if you have a predominance of unhealthy bacteria in your gut and you're eating grains and carbs, you're feeding those microbes. So your good bacteria can't get a handhold in there because you're daily strengthening the pathogenic bacteria and yeast, because yeast is another. And then now we have bacterial fungal hybrids, like the mycobacterium. Well, they eat sugar too. So, I mean, sugar, think about it, trees. What do trees eat? Trees eat sugar. They grow to 200 feet tall on sugar. Sugar is a very potent food source, and pretty much all organisms eat and thrive on sugar. So it's not that sugar's this evil substance. I think we need to get rid of that. I think we need to get out of the thing of saying sugar's bad. Sugar is a foundation of life. Breast milk, I don't know, because I've had three kids, I've drunk my own breast milk. Breast milk is super sweet. And I've drunk my dog's milk, and I've drunk my cat. You know, like any milk you drink when I was a kid, I milked my dogs. I was like, I wonder what that tastes like. They're all really sweet. They're all really high in sugars, because that's what sustains life and creates maximum growth. So that's the other thing we have to keep in mind, that it's just about what's in your gut already, because that's what you're feeding. So if you want to keep that candida and all those pathogens alive and robust, stay on your grains, stay on your sugar. But if you want to, we're talking like if you've got MAP, you're looking at a 2 to 3 year process to get rid of those, because they have a dormant active life cycle. So my wild oregano oil protocol, which combines wild oregano all day and then high dose Natron probiotics at night, you have to cycle off and on that for 2 years, but then you'll feel better. You'll feel better the whole time as you go along. And then you'll feel better because you'll have killed everything that's active, and you'll be like, I feel amazing. And then maybe a few weeks or you're like, I'm starting to feel crap again. You go, this didn't work. No, it's because the next batch is coming active again. They're coming to life. So you go back on the protocol and you kill that batch. You feel amazing. And then you cycle like this for 2 to 3 years. That's how long it takes. But meanwhile, and in the in-between phases, when you feel good, you're hitting the probiotics really hard because, you know, you've killed off a big population that was preventing those. So you want to get those. And maybe you're doing the probiotic retention enema during that time period. So the sugars are, you know, if you, and I mean, there's actually clinical studies on how grains affect people with colitis. I've got some of them, I quote some of them in my book. So the ideal thing that I tell people is, and with gluten, like when you said you tried gluten, did you mean you had wheat?
Yes.
Yeah. So we have the wheat in North America has been so mutated that that's why most people are like, oh, I'm gluten intolerant. No, it's our North American wheat. I have naturopaths that I do tell seminars with, and like this one woman, she has an entire clientele of, she specializes in hormone balance. She has hundreds of women who can't eat wheat in North America. And whenever they go over to France or Italy, where they have protected their heritage wheat strains, and they don't use pesticides, and they don't use, like the grain is what people ate hundreds of years ago, they can eat bread and pasta with no problem. So that's another thing. We have to look at how agribusiness has changed those fundamental grains that we are consuming. So we're not looking at, oh, well, this is a natural grain. Humans have eaten wheat for thousands of years. Yeah, not the wheat we're eating, though. So that's another thing to take into consideration. So for people with IBD and IBS, absolutely, get off the grains, all grains, for a period of time, and then go low grain and stick to things like quinoa and millet. And, you know, although, see, then we're back into the balancing. Because if you have someone who's already malnourished and can maybe tolerate 10 foods, and you tell them stop eating rice, well, they're probably going to lose weight because they need to, rice is the kind of the thing that's keeping them going, because it's, so there you're back into that balancing, right? And the elemental diet product we talked about, it has a carbohydrate component. It has tapioca maltodextrin, which is a glucose polymer. Without it, you will not gain weight. You will receive your protein and your amino acids and all your bread, but you will stay malnourished. You will stay 99 pounds. Maybe you'll get up to 100, 101. But for you to get to up to that healthy weight, you have to give the body that carbohydrate for that period of time. So guess what's going to happen while you're on that? Your candida is going to go up too, because your candida is like, yoo-hoo, we love maltodextrin. So again, you're back into the balancing of the healing in layers. You can't heal every, these diseases are multi-systemic, they're multi-layered. You can't heal it, boom, all at once. So you got to go for the big stuff first. If you're hemorrhaging and you're malnourished, that's more important than candida. So you go, let's clear those. But the other thing we realized after, again, thousands of people testing, when you go on the elemental diet, from day one, you start the wild oregano oil protocol. So you are helping your body and you're keeping that candida from going hog wild. So you stay on it the whole time you're on the diet. And we realize now that, yes, wild oregano is safe for people in extreme disease states and all the rest of it. And then when you finish the elemental diet, you stay on it. And then you're probably on it for 2 years to kill that cycle of mycobacteria that we talked about. So you're kind of coming at it from several layers simultaneously. So again, someone who's severely malnourished may not be able to get off all the grains and carbs. And then someone who, let's say you are at a decent weight, you can get rid of all the grains and carbs for a period. And then you probably want to start, you know, having some potatoes and some yams. And so have your starches, but have them in vegetable form would be better than going to grains. So that kind of build in, because if you go without, and I've done this, I've gone without any for up to a year at a time. And it's interesting what happens with the body. Like I have the most vitality and I need the least amount of sleep, but my body gets really lean and sinewy, like an Arctic wolf, right? Like in the winter, not in the spring. I start feeling I need some carbs. So then we're into, you know, there's a balance there. And then you need to, yeah, you need to find that, and you need to find the forms of carbohydrates that your body likes the most. And again, then we're into the mind-body interplay. Like you're going through a really stressful time. Maybe you need some chocolate, right? And maybe you need some, like I make my own chocolate and it's sweetened with stevia and a little bit of xylitol because I can tolerate xylitol. A lot of people can't. And, you know, some chopped up dried fruit. But there's times where you're like, I need some sugar because this is like super stressful and I hate my life. And me having, you know, a few pieces of real chocolate is going to change my evening and I'm going to go to bed feeling happy and positive, well, how much healing is that giving you? So there's always that dialing into your heart, dialing into your gut, looking for the balance, what's right at this time.
You're talking to a big foodie. We're just putting together a food book. Then I teach food classes and how to eat super healthy. And when you're talking about carbohydrates and also those monosaccharide carbohydrates, such as squash, I found much easier on my gut than potatoes. The monosaccharides, when the mucosal lining and the villi are flattened with inflammation. So yeah, finding the perfect ones at the time, and then maybe after you can add that little bit of yam. So I won't keep you much longer. I would just really love to ask you one more question if I could. Mm-hmm. And it's on the etiology of the microbiome that you see or the gut bacteria with people with inflammatory bowel disease. So you talked about yeast and candida and different mycotoxicity. What are some of the other etiology that you see, maybe some low probiotic strains that are part of the etiology? Maybe you could speak to that a bit for me.
I would say, mercury, we talked about one, right? But people often won't put it together. So mercury and any other kind of environmental poisoning and toxin, which can be in your water supply, can be in your air, there can be mold, right, in the walls or the floor of your house, the carpets, you know, all of these types of things can put either a low-grade continual stress, or they can actually be a single causative explosive substance, right? And it just depends on, again, where you're at and how much there is and what your exposure level is. Microwave radiation, so Wi-Fi, cell phones. I've been banging on about this for, 8 or 9 years now, but nobody's listening. I'll tell you right now, not even my own kids. My own kids fight me every day. Like, how we have Wi-Fi in the house? But it's a stressor. It's something that our cells don't recognize that wavelength pattern, and they armor, so they harden. If you've got cell walls that are hardening, you don't have adequate detoxification pathways, you don't have adequate nutrition, respiration, all that type of stuff happening. And we have tons of studies on animals and plants showing the effects of Wi-Fi and cell phones. So my way around that is, I don't have Wi-Fi in my house, everything's hardwired. Nobody's allowed to have their cell phone on in the house. Outside, you can't control it, right? It's everywhere. So outside, I've experimented with this, and I tell my body, we're safe. Let the waves pass through us and out the other side. You don't need to armor. It's okay. Because every nighttime or whatever part of the day, when you go home, you have a place to repair and rejuvenate. And I think that's what's key to preventing. I think that, you know, I tell my kids, I'm like, you know, what you're saying to me is, you know, when I was a kid, everybody smoked, you know, and you remember the ads and they're blowing smoke into the face of a baby, showing you how safe it is. This is not a, your medical doctor. I'm a medical doctor and I smoke. I mean, those ads are still out there on the internet. That's what Wi-Fi is today. Everybody's telling you how safe it is, and nobody's actually looking at the research. And if they did, and the industry is paying massive amounts of money to have all the research killed, so you don't ever see it in any media unless you're actually looking for it. I said, you're saying to me, let's have everybody, all four of you, smoking in my house. Well, I'm moving out. Sorry. That's not. So again, cigarette smoke, right? Everybody knows how that triggers colitis and Crohn's. Now, it may have a calming effect because of the nicotine to the smoker, but at the same time, it has a damaging effect. So those are all your environmental and then your foodborne toxins, right? And everything you put on your skin, your shampoo, your body lotion, microwave foods, chlorine, all the heavy metals, your furniture, your cosmetics, like everything is absorbed by the skin, the lungs. It all creates your matrix that either supports your healing or makes it harder. Mm-hmm. And you know, you're trying to hear something, you have all these things that are knocking your body down and giving your body additional stuff to fight against, you know, it's just going to take you longer and maybe you'll never fully get there. Then we have all the pathogens and parasites. So we have all of those causative factors that are in the body themselves. And again, whether you were breastfed, whether you had a vaginal birth versus cesarean, so you were lacking that foundational bacteria right from the start, those have play into the etiology of these diseases. Then you have things like vaccination. Right? So seeding the body with latent proviruses, all the adjuvants that they add to the vaccines, like mercury, and, you know, taken out mercury, they've replaced it with other things. Vaccines are also cultured using foreign genetic materials. So you're putting like monkey genes into your body. And I mean, you're just putting these challenges on the immune system that, you know, we're not really, humans have never dealt with these things before. And so I look at all of these things and I say, you know, these are, and then of course, antibiotic use, right? And when you received antibiotics, were they followed with high dose therapeutic probiotics? Pretty much nobody, except my kids maybe. So, and my pets, even my animals ever get exposure to, they get their probiotics, you know, high dose for at least a few weeks and then ongoing for about 3 months to put that good bacterial flora back in. So you have all of these things kind of swirling together. And then for each person, there's going to be a different mix of those that trigger their particular biome or their particular mind-body makeup. Because let's say you just have antibiotics and child abuse, like physical or sexual abuse. For some person, that's enough. Those two things are all you need to have Crohn's or colitis. For some people, they're fine. Totally fine. I hear from elderly people all the time, I've never had a gut problem in my life. And I went for my, you know, scheduled colonoscopy, which the doctor told me, and now I have colitis. Yeah, because they can't sterilize the colonoscopes, which again, most GIs don't even know about, but it's there. Look through all the infectious medical journals, infectious disease, infectious microbiology. All the data is there. The sterilant that they do use, which gets most of it, is called glutaraldehyde. The hospital personnel face mask and have extra thick rubber gloves because if you touch it, it burns your skin. They're bathing the colonoscope in that and then shoving it up your rectum. Glutaraldehyde alone causes colitis. So you have medical procedures, exploratory and diagnostic tests and preventative procedures that are stripping your bacterial flora because you know, the test prep, you have to clean out your colon. So now you got nothing in there. And now I'm going to put an infected disease scope in there that's been soaked in a substance that causes burning on contact. You know, it's just insane the types of things that we do that all contribute. And again, you know, depending on where your body is, where your microbiome's at, what you follow it, what your diet is, you know, and what you're normally, it's amazing how resilient our bodies actually are. You know, that everybody isn't breaking down like long ago. And, you know, you realize, wow, the body actually has a very strong self-healing capability. And we really have to salt it to get to this level. Or have a triggering emotional event, right? With just one or two things.
Very challenging to be healthy in this world. And so in order to not get disease, we have to do so much.
Yes.
Such a world with so much electromagnetic frequency and pollution. And I have been avoiding colonoscopies for a long, long time. And I actually had a sigmoidoscopy scheduled and I think I will cancel it again. So thank you for that reminder because I had read a couple articles on that whole thing. And so I'm assuming you don't get checkups and haven't for many, many decades. So
no, I have not. I think, when was my last one? 35 years ago, maybe. But for the sigmoidoscopy, if your body wisdom is telling you to do that, they have disposable sigmoidoscopes. Mm-hmm. So you can make sure you say it must be disposable. And then I have a blog post on, I just called it Dangers of Colonoscopy. And in there, I have a report, and it gives you a procedure to follow pre and post. So if you do decide to get that done, just follow the procedure before the sigmoidoscopy and afterwards, and that will greatly lessen the impact and the risks.
Great information, Jini. Thank you. Would you have a couple last pearls of wisdom for us here today?
Well, I just think you should get your stuff out there. I love what you're talking about the recipes and the approach of, like seeing that as your little crystal ball in your gut. I mean, that is amazing of this gift of this, whoop, you need to set a boundary. Whoop, you need to, like your gut tells you instantly. And I think that's huge. I think there's a big audience for that message. That's a book I would be all over recommending to my people because it's a missing piece. And if they can just have a perspective shift, that alone will change their lives. Regardless of everything else you're putting in the book, that piece would be enough to change their lives. A recipe book, if you can come up with that, and I don't know if it'll work, but you have my Listen to Your Gut book? Mm-hmm. Okay, so if you can tag the recipes according to which one is safe for the reduced diarrhea diet, which one is safe for the minimized gas and bloating diet, because I give a booklet that comes with the book. I don't know if you received that. There's a healing recipe booklet on there, and I've said, and then I changed it's the same recipe, but I've changed it slightly as to whether which diet you're on. But if you could have a recipe book where you also have some of them or a lot of them tagged to which diet, then I've got readers who would buy it tomorrow. And that's a resource that, you know, is definitely needed. And something else. I'm really excited about that. I would love to, you know, help get that out there because, you know, like I said, if I can point people to something that's already there, I'd rather do that than me having to do it myself. And I think I love the space you're coming from. And, you know, I can see there's a total resonance with everything that you're saying and I'm saying. So I would be so on board for helping you get your stuff out there.
Thank you. That might be our next ebook. This book is called Inspire Me. So it's basic plant-based, mostly live food recipes that I can't say are safe for anyone with Crohn's and colitis at this point. It's more of an inspiration book on really clean, beautiful, rainbow food, incorporating, juice cleansing and stuff like that. But I certainly will give that a lot of energy because that was where I was a bit... It's such a diverse disease. And for me, I had very little problem with fiber, except for the very beginning times when I'm, or in and out of acute flare up where I go to just liquid for a little while. Mm-hmm. Whereas my girlfriend who has Crohn's can't handle any fiber and still can't after 7-8 years. I know part of it is because she keeps telling herself that. I know that's a huge part of it. And when I bring that to her attention, she doesn't want to hear it. She's got this primal diet down pat. So I'm actually quite curious about the whole mind-body thing, almost more than anything, and the whole gut-heart-brain connection, because I do know that she hasn't wavered much from her primal diet, which is raw meat, raw cream, raw milk, raw... some probiotics, a little bit of fiber food, because she's told herself for 8 years, if she goes off it, she'll be sick. So I would never, ever want to tell myself that because I love food and I love the diversity of food too much.
Me too.
And you know the power of what I tell myself.
Exactly.
So,
thank you. Well, it's interesting. You might want to go on my blog and Google food allergy because, and there's two posts where I pulled in this one gal. She has a PhD in immunology and experimental medicine. Beautiful. And then another gal who she's been a holistic health counselor and she teaches cooking. And so she's been focused on the whole food aspect of helping people regain their health through food. So we pulled in the three of us to go, okay, we need to talk about this frickin' food allergy stuff because there's something wrong with what everyone's saying. And these IgA blood tests, like there's something wrong with that too, because, you know, I've had all of them done and it gives you this list and I'm like, I'm not allergic to that. I know because I've done the gold standard, which is to do an elemental diet, eliminate all foods and then put them back in one by one and then test. And then also nobody's talking about the fact that your tolerance is variable according to your stress levels. And your tolerance can also be cumulative. So you may tolerate something in this amount 3 times a week. But if you have it 4 now you're intolerant. So no one's talking about those levels of tolerance. So then it's not about making our lives like your friend, making her life as barren as possible in order to stay safe. It's about entering more into that dialogue and saying, well, I really love that thing. Maybe I can have it once a week. Maybe I can have it once a month, but I don't have to deny myself. So I'm not in austerity. I'm in abundance. I'm in, you know, like when you talked about food and
how can I make this food that I love into something that I can make that's healthy? That's where my passion is. How can I teach you how to make this amazing pizza that's raw and with gluten and all these nutrients? Yeah. The opposite of deprivation, because I still feel anything but deprived, but yes.
Exactly. And when you feel deprived, if you think about deprivation, that's a contracting, clamping state. What's your gut doing? Mm-hmm. Right? Like, what have you just introduced energetically as a reality in existence for your body? Really? Does that feel like flow and vibrancy and vitality and abundance? No, it's the opposite. Mm-hmm. So I'm totally with you there. And so anything like that, that you can produce, I would love to be able to get out to, you know, all of my people and my readers. I think that'd be amazing. I fully support you to do that.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your time.
You're welcome, Tami.